Sorry, everybody watching on Facebook Live. One of the most well-known verses in all the Bible is Matthew chapter 7, verse 1. Some of you are saying, wait, I don't even know what Matthew chapter 7, verse 1. You'll recognize it when I say it. Most people can quote it. Judge not, lest ye be judged. Judge not, lest ye be judged. And they take the first part of that verse, they pull it out of context, they don't read the whole portion of Scripture, which is the next six verses, and they pull that text out of context. If you read all the first six verses of Matthew 7, you see it's talking about hypocritical judgment. It's talking about don't judge others and try to take the speck out of somebody else's eye. If you've got a log in your own eye, first take the beam or the log out of your own eye, and then help take the speck out of your brother's eye. Making judgments about doctrine and about behavior is something we're called to do. We're called to do it throughout Scripture. Paul, throughout the Bible, tells us, beware of false teachers. How do you know who's a false teacher? You got to make a judgment about that. We're called to not even associate with those who profess to be Christians and who are living immoral lives. That requires judgment. So what's Paul talking about here? He says, verse 1 and 2, accept him whose faith is weak without passing judgment on disputable matters. That word disputable matters, really important. There are big matters we're to pass judgment on, but on disputable matters, we're not to. We're to accept him whose faith is weak. By the way, the very fact that Paul is saying there's one guy whose faith is weak and another guy whose faith is strong is a judgment, right? One man's faith, he says, allows him to eat everything, but another man whose faith is weak eats only vegetables. Paul mentions those who have weak faith, the ones who are eating only vegetables. Now, if you're here this morning or you're watching on YouTube or Facebook Live and you're a vegetarian for health reasons, it does not mean that your faith is necessarily weak. What Paul is talking about here is something unique that was taking place in the church in Rome. So you remember in the church in Rome, you have Jews and you have Gentiles. And those of you who are familiar with the Old Testament know that in the Old Testament, there were all kinds of very specific dietary restrictions that God's people were called to observe. Dietary restrictions that were meant to distinguish them from the rest of the nations of the earth. So, for example, you might remember in the book of Daniel, right? After the Babylonians had sacked Jerusalem, they took the best and brightest and exiled them into Babylon. And some of those best and brightest were Daniel and then Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And they were going to be trained and they were going to eat at the king's table and they were going to serve in the government of Babylon. That was a strategy to assimilate conquered people so that they would feel like they were Babylonians and now have new loyalties. And Daniel and Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were all told they could eat at the king's table. But they were under the conviction, and actually in the Old Testament, they were under the command that there were certain foods they weren't supposed to eat. So they said, just let us eat vegetables. Why? Because the food at the king's table wasn't kosher. It wasn't in accord with a special diet that God had given to his people to set them apart as a distinct people from among the rest of the nations of the earth. So some people ask, well, if you really believe the Bible and there's all these dietary laws in the Bible, why don't you keep kosher? I've been to potlucks here and there's pulled pork and there's bacon and there's ham. For those of you who are new, when we will eventually have potlucks again. We're just not there yet. Well, the reason we have those things at our potlucks is because of things that we read in the New Testament. For example, in Mark chapter 7, Jesus declares all foods are clean. Mark chapter 7, verse 18, 19, and 20. Are you so dull? He asked Jesus, Don't you see that nothing that enters a man from the outside can make him unclean? For it doesn't go into his heart, but into his stomach and then out of his body. In saying this, Jesus declared all foods clean. He went on, what comes out of a man is what makes him unclean. Not only that, in the book of Acts, Peter, who was kind of the number one disciple of Jesus, he had this vision of this big sheet that came down from heaven, and he heard in this sheet were all kinds of unclean animals, and he heard God say, kill and eat, and he said, surely not, Lord. I've never eaten anything impure or unclean. The voice spoke to him a second time, do not call anything impure that God has made clean. So the dietary restrictions that God had given to his people in the Old Testament to distinguish them from all the nations of the earth, those restrictions were lifted in the New Testament era. But apparently in the church, there were some believers in the church in Rome who were having difficulty eating food that their whole life they deemed unclean. So when they went to a Roman church potluck and they saw bacon, they didn't feel like they had the freedom to eat it. They didn't feel like they could eat the ham. They wouldn't go to the lobster fest, if you would. So here you have Paul, a fellow Jew, calling those Jews weak in the faith because they were having a hard time letting go of their kosher convictions. Now this language of strong and weak isn't unique to the book of Romans. It's interesting, we see something parallel taking place in the book of 1 Corinthians. Paul talks about a group of Christians in the church in Corinth who have weak consciences who can't eat food sacrificed to idols. Now you see, in Corinth, food and drink offerings would be brought before pagan gods, and the gods wouldn't actually come down and eat them, right? Because gods don't come down and eat food. But they'd be offered up, and then the priest would eat some of the food, and the leftover they would take to the market and sell, and sometimes that food would be a little cheaper, and some Christians felt they had all the liberty in the world to just go and buy that beef that had been sacrificed to a certain god. But there were other people who didn't feel like they could do that in good conscience. Some of those Christians refused to buy that meat offered to idols. Others felt the freedom to do that. Now, in Corinth, do you think it was Jews who were having a problem with meat offered to idols? Probably not. It was probably the Gentile pagans. Gentile pagans who had frequented those temples and seen that meat and maybe even in the previous life engaged in some of the practices that went around those kinds of offerings that were taking place. And those were reminders to them of what had taken place. Paul's saying, look, you're free to eat that meat that was offered to the idols. And they're like, oh, I can't. It brings back too many bad memories of things I've done in the past. Paul calls them weak. So here you have two different letters and two different circumstances. You have a letter to the church in Rome and a letter to the church in Corinth. The church in Rome, it's this group of Jews who are weak. In the church in Corinth, it's this group of Gentiles that are weak. And the reason they were both weak is because they hadn't brought the gospel to bear fully on their unique situation. The Jews in Rome didn't recognize the freedom they had to not keep kosher. The Gentiles in Corinth didn't recognize the freedom they had to eat this meat sacrificed to idols. Friends, the Bible tells us that who the Son has set free is free indeed. So they were both weak, different ethnic groups, because they were adding to the gospel. In Rome, it was the gospel plus keep kosher. In Corinth, it was the gospel plus, don't eat that food offered to idols. Friends, we're meant to have the gospel influence and infiltrate all of our lives. We're to bring the gospel to bear in every situation. And it's interesting how God uses other cultures to help us do that at times. In the church in Rome, he used Gentiles to teach Jews. that they had the freedom not to keep kosher. In Corinth, he used Jews to show Gentiles they had the freedom to eat meat sacrificed to idols. See, every culture has its own set of idols that need to be torn down. We all have things that we are prone to add to the gospel, even us white Americans who don't think we have a culture, which we really do. Which is why it's so important that we let brothers and sisters from different cultures bring the gospel to bear in our lives and learn from them. Verse 1 says, "Accept him whose faith is weak without passing judgment on disputable matters. One man's faith allows him to eat everything, but the other man whose faith is weak eats only vegetables. The man who eats everything must not look down on him who does not. The man who does not eat everything must not condemn the man who does, for God has accepted him. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? To his own master he stands or falls, and he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. One man considers one day more sacred than another. Another man considers every day alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. He who regards one day as special does so to the Lord. He who eats meat eats to the Lord, for he gives thanks to God. And he who abstains does so to the Lord and gives thanks to God." The first thing I want you to see is, in disputed matters, we're not to argue. Don't argue about disputed matters. Agree to disagree on secondary and tertiary matters. There's a famous quote that's been attributed to Augustine, to Maeterlinck, probably the best evidence I can find is it's from Marco Antonio de Dominis. It goes like this: "In essentials, unity; in non-essentials, liberty; and in all things, charity." In essentials, unity; in non-essentials, liberty; and in all things, charity. It's a great saying, and I think it sums up the spirit of this chapter. So Paul doesn't only address diets; he addresses days. Okay. In particular here, what's probably going on is Jewish feast days. So as Christians, we don't celebrate Jewish feast days. We don't celebrate Yom Kippur or Rosh Hashanah, but because we see them as pointing to Jesus the Messiah and those feast days really being fulfilled in him. So apparently, some Jews who came to Christ stopped celebrating those feast days, and others kept celebrating those feast days. So you have Jews who come to Christ. Some are like, "Yeah, I don't do Passover anymore." And others are like, "Yeah, I still celebrate Passover." One man considers one day more sacred than another. Another man considers every day alike. Each one should be fully convinced in his own mind. So let's apply that to today. In our day and age, there are messianic synagogues comprised of Jewish Christians who still celebrate Passover. I have absolutely no problem with that. They have the freedom to do that. I don't think Paul would have a problem with that either. What I would have a problem with, and what I think Paul would have a problem with, is if they came to our church and said, "You guys aren't really Christians because you don't celebrate Passover." I'd also have a problem with somebody going to their synagogue and saying, "You're not really Christians because you still celebrate Passover." Again, in essentials, unity; in non-essentials, liberty; and in all things, charity. There are essentials in the Bible that relate to doctrine and duty, to belief and behavior. Paul spent the first 11 chapters of this book of Romans talking to us about essential beliefs, things like justification by faith. Those aren't areas we compromise on. So beliefs, we confess the Apostles' Creed, essential. Jesus is God, essential. Jesus lived a perfect, sinless life, essential. He was born of a virgin, essential. In his death, he accomplished something on a cosmic level, making a way by which sinful men could be reconciled to a holy God, essential. He rose bodily from the dead, essential. He will return to judge the living and the dead, essential. The timing of his return? Non-essential. Faithful Christians who fully believe God's inerrant, inspired word understand the timing of his return differently. There are people here at Tribuco Canyon Community Church who believe in this, what you would call the secret rapture of the church, that the church will be caught up before the Great Tribulation. There are other people who believe that Christ will return after the tribulation. And I'm fine with that. Half of you are wrong. I'm not sure which one yet. But this is a secondary area. What I'm not fine with is the secret rapture pre-tribbers looking at the post-tribbers and saying, oh, you just don't have enough faith for a miraculous event like the rapture to take place. I'm not fine with that. I'm not fine with the post-tribbers saying to the pre-tribbers, you're just wimps and are afraid to suffer. Not fine with that either. Friends, we all ought to pray for Jesus to come and come quickly. Some of you are like, I don't know what a pre-tribber is and a post-tribber is. Yeah. Let me encourage you to embrace another alternative. It's called the pan-tribber. It'll all pan out in the end. Okay, that's a good alternative for you. Okay. Baptism. Essential. Mode of baptism? Again, faithful Christians who believe God's word can reach different understandings on modes of baptism. The Lord's Supper, essential. What takes place at the Lord's Supper? Non-essential. There are faithful Christians who believe that celebration of the Lord's Supper is simply a remembrance that we do, that nothing supernatural takes place there. There are others who say, no, wait a minute. It's a means of grace, and God meets us when we're united as a church and fellowship around the table in a unique and special way. Again, we have people in the church who fall into both of those camps. These are just some of the disputable matters as it relates to belief. There are also essential matters in the church as it relates to behavior. For the Christian, sex belongs in marriage and only in marriage. Essential. For the Christian, we may not bear false witness against our neighbor. Essential. For the Christian, we may not murder. Essential. Can a Christian kill? If someone breaks into your home, can you defend yourself with lethal force? That's a disputed matter. Can a Christian serve in the military, which might involve taking a life? Disputed matter. Some of you might remember the story of Desmond Doss, the story was made popular with the movie Hacksaw Ridge. He joined the army to serve his nation. He was a committed follower of God, but he was also a pacifist and refused to carry a gun. And he joined as a medic and saved dozens of lives on a single day. Here specifically, Paul talks about certain days that some observe and some do not. So, here at Tribuco Canyon Community Church, one of my favorite services of the year is our Christmas Eve candlelight service. One of my favorite services of the year. Imagine we have a guy named Nick, who's a Christian, and Nick attends our church. I picked the name Nick because we don't have any Nicks at church. But he's convinced in his own mind that December 25th was picked to celebrate Jesus' birth because it overlapped with certain pagan holidays, and he doesn't feel right about celebrating Christmas. After all, there's not a mandate in the Bible to celebrate Christmas. Nick doesn't come to church on Christmas Eve. I'm okay with that. I'm not okay with Nick skipping church on Sundays, because the Bible talks clearly about that, but there's no mandated Christmas Eve service in the Bible. What I'm not okay with is Nick starting to go around in church saying, well, we're not really a Christian church because we celebrate Christmas Eve, which has its roots in paganism. Again, Romans 14, verse 3. The man who eats everything must not look down on him who does not. The man who does not eat everything must not condemn the man who does. For God has accepted him. Who are you to judge someone else's servant? To his own master he stands or falls. And he will stand, for the Lord is able to make him stand. So we're not to look down on or condemn brothers or sisters over disputed matters. There's something about our humanity that likes to distinguish itself, that likes to create its own little special righteousness to show that we're superior or better to other people. And unfortunately, God has not delivered all of us from that when we became Christians. And so we are prone to add to the gospel. So we add to the gospel with things like the gospel plus abstinence from alcohol. We're a real Christian church. We don't drink. Or the gospel plus abstinence from card playing. We're real Christians. We don't play cards. The gospel plus abstaining from R-rated movies. We're real Christians. We don't watch any R-rated movies ever. The gospel plus speaking in tongues. We're real Christians. We speak in tongues. The gospel plus women's head covering. We're real Christians. Our women wear head coverings when they enter into the sanctuary. The gospel plus Sabbatarianism. We're real Christians. The only thing we ever do on Sunday is go to church. We don't even go out to restaurants because then we're making somebody else violate the Sabbath. The gospel plus homeschooling. The gospel plus home birthing. The gospel plus anti-vax. The gospel plus essential oils. We can add. And I use essential oils. They're fine. And I'm fine with you homeschooling. What I'm not fine with you doing is going around and saying, unless you do this, you're not really a Christian. So we're not to look down our nose at our brothers and sisters because they're exercising their freedoms in certain areas. This is what happens when we stop making the main thing the main thing. In essentials, unity. At the core of our identity as believers needs to be our union with Christ above all else, above everything. And in those areas that we can agree to disagree, we don't look down our nose at our brothers and sisters. Much news was made the last 2 weeks when Grace Community Church in Sun Valley opened their doors. Big to-dos. Even though we've been open for weeks before that. Tribuco Canyon Community Church is open. And the elders of our church, we prayed, we sought the Lord for wisdom on how to lead the church well in this time. And then we felt in our context, it was best to give people options. We can socially distance inside, we can have patio seating, the patio seating outside, lawn seating, seating in the cars. And I have friends who are pastors who are preaching in churches and nobody's there on Sunday morning. They're just preaching to a camera still. They haven't met in any form. And I love these men. If you moved, I'd recommend you visit their churches and see if they were a good fit for you. Just because the leadership here at Tribuco Canyon Community Church is convinced that the Lord wants us to be open at this season doesn't mean that other churches who are not open yet are not hearing from the Lord or are not being faithful to the gospel. In the time of a pandemic, this is a disputed matter. And so we need to be gracious to our brothers and sisters who worship in different contexts. I was thinking about how best to illustrate this, what Paul's preaching against here. Have any of you ever watched Phineas and Ferb? Okay, some of you who have kids or grandkids, there's this great cartoon called Phineas and Ferb, and my kids were raised on Phineas and Ferb, Little House on the Prairie, and I Love Lucy. Those were like our go-to. Our go-to shows. Well, Phineas and Ferb is about two boys who who are trying to figure out what to do during summer vacation, and they're constantly inventing things. And they have this older sister named Candace. And Candace is always trying to bust her brothers. Always. She's always looking for ways to get them in trouble. And they build these incredible inventions, and she gets mom, and mom comes over, and the invention somehow disappeared or is gone or something like that. Candace is trying to be Phineas and Ferb's parent instead of their sister. Did any of you have older siblings who thought they were your parents? Have any of you experienced that, right? This is the kind of attitude that Paul's preaching against here. In disputed matters, stop worrying about them. Why do we pretend to be Candace all the time? What does it say in verse 6? He who regards one day as special does so to the Lord. He who eats meat eats to the Lord and gives thanks to God. He who abstains does so to the Lord and gives thanks to God. So in disputed matters, we're to be convinced in our own minds and give thanks instead of worrying about what other people are doing. We're to give thanks to God for what we have the freedom to do, or to give thanks to God for the things that we don't have to do. So, not only are we to be charitable when it comes to disputed matters, we're to decide what's worth living for and dying for. I mentioned this passage in my prayer this morning. Romans 14:7, none of us lives to himself alone, and none of us dies to himself alone. If we live, we live to God. If we die to the Lord. So whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. For this very reason, Christ died and returned to life so that he might be the Lord of both the dead and the living. Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote, when Christ calls a man, he bids him to come and die. I hope every one of you hearing me, my voice this morning would say that Jesus is worth living and dying for. Our culture with its wealth and its consumerism ingrains in us a sense of choice and constant pursuit of happiness, of following our dreams, doing whatever makes us feel good. We're not to follow our dreams, we're to follow Jesus. We're to follow Jesus, not our dreams. Sometimes those things might overlap, but it says here, if we live, we live to the Lord. If we die to the Lord. Whether we live or die, we belong to the Lord. If you're a Christian, you are a blood-bought child of the Most High God. If we believed the gospel, if we believe that Jesus really entered into this broken world and lived the perfect life of righteousness and offered himself as a sacrifice for sin and conquered death, if we believe that, you don't belong to yourself anymore. You belong to God. We say you're a good, good father. Yes, he's good, but he's also father. And a father actually has wisdom and instruction and guidance for his children. In view of God's mercies, we're to present ourselves as living sacrifices. Paul is saying to you, if you belong to Christ in life and death, guess what? That means your brother or sister belongs to Christ in life and death. So in disputed matters, you have freedom and liberty. Be convinced in your own mind that what you're doing is pleasing to God. Our Tuesday morning's men's study, we're reading through a book on seven men. And this last week we started reading about the life of William Wilberforce. William Wilberforce was the man who almost single-handedly, he had help, but he was the man who abolished slavery in England. And while he had some Christian influences in his early life, he grew up in his young life. His parents found out that he was becoming evangelical. They snagged him away from his aunt and uncle where he was staying and indoctrinated him in worldliness. And he grew up he grew up like a playboy, basically. And he entered into politics. And he eventually came to Christ. And when he did, he had to make a decision. He thought about exiting politics. There was so much stuff in his life, so much shady dealing in politics. He's like, I don't think I can be a Christian and be a politician. And he had a long talk with John Newton, the former slave trader, the man who wrote the song Amazing Grace, who convinced him to stay in politics. And after he was convinced and they discussed this, he reconciled in his own mind. He was convinced in his own mind that what he was going to do would be pleasing to God. And he is the man God used to free the slaves in England. Decide what's living and dying for. For all of us, it should be Jesus. And sometimes there are other things that will be living worth living and dying for. My family is worth living and dying for. I'm willing to get arrested if they come to take me away this morning. Some of you have already promised bail money, so that's good. But we are to live for Christ in life and in death. And last, we're to defer to the judgment of Christ. Romans 14, 10, 11, and 12. You then, why do you judge your brother? Why do you look down on your brother? For we will all stand before God's judgment seat, as it's written, as surely as I live, says the Lord, every knee will bow and every tongue confess to God. So then each of us will give an account of himself to God. Friends, when we stand before the Lord on the day of judgment, I don't think we're going to be worried about the guy in front of us or the person behind us. I think we'll have enough of. I think we'll have enough to worry about. Michael, this is for you. You remember in that great movie Miracle, Herb Brooks gives a speech to rally the troops and Mike Urizoni. Says something about how hard Herb's being on one of the other players. Herb says, you need to be quiet. You got enough to worry about in your game. We have enough to worry about in our own lives because we will all stand before the judgment seat of God and we'll give an account, including an account of how we loved our brothers and sisters. We live in a culture of instant gratification where we press buttons on our food, on our phone, and things magically appear on our doorstep, whether it be Thai food or toilet paper or books or groceries. And in that kind of culture of instant gratification, it's hard to think about long-term accountability. But the Bible says here, the day is coming when every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. As Christians, this won't be unusual or hard for us because we, as followers of Jesus, bow our knee to him every day. And this day is coming. And if you have yet to turn to Christ in faith and repentance, I implore you, turn from your sin and trust in Jesus. Follow him. Bow your knee freely and joyfully in faith and repentance and find the eternal life that he offers to all who will come. Believe in the gospel of Christ's victory over death. Live for him. Die for him. Jesus said, come, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Would you bow your heads in prayer with me this morning? Heavenly Father, we thank you for the admonishment from your word. We thank you for the freedom that you've given us in Christ. Lord, it's so easy to be convinced in our own mind of secondary matters and think that we need to convince everybody else about these same secondary matters. And that's not what you've called us to. He who the Son has set free is free indeed. So you've called us to freedom. You've called us to liberty. You've called us to, Lord, to inessentials unity, to in non-essentials liberty, and in all things charity. So help us be loving. Help us build up and exhort and minister well to our brothers and sisters in Christ. And Lord, for those who may be listening or watching online who aren't yet a brother and sister in Christ, I pray this day, even now, that by your grace, by the work of your Spirit, you would draw them to yourself. You would open their eyes to see the beauty and wonder of who you are and what you've done. That they might find the freedom and joy and life that is only found in you. We pray these things in Christ's precious name. Amen. I'm going to ask the worship team to come back up, and we're going to close in song.
Amazing how relevant God's word is to our daily circumstances, isn't it? There's so much confusion this season, what churches are doing, what we should be doing, but charity and all of these things, and Christian freedoms, that's good. The song, Come Thou Long Expected Jesus, just asking him to come, and as he had his first coming, he will come again, and we live in light of that. You know, if you want to stand, you can stand with us.
Come thou long expected Jesus, born to set thy people free. From our fears and sins release us, let us find our rest in thee. Israel's strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art. To deliver, born as child and yet a king, born to reign in us forever. Now thy gracious kingdom bring, by thine own eternal spirit, rule in all our hearts alone. By
please stand for the benediction. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine brightly upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace as you go in his grace. Agreeing to disagree. God bless you.